We move on to the last part of macroeconomics, which is which deals with consumption and investment. Now, these terms, consumption and investments, they are very much related. I'll tell you the relation between them, and then we will study this chapter in detail. Now, what exactly is consumption and what actually is investments? Say, for example, if I'm earning an amount of 1 lakh rupees a month, so that becomes my income, okay? Out of that income, I wish to spend 70,000 on my on all the types of goods and services that I wish to buy. So from that 70,000, whatever is left is 30,000, which I probably save it in the bank, right? For my future requirements. Now, whatever I have saved, that 30,000, I can use it for my future. What banks actually do is, if any businessman comes to the bank in requirement of money, in requirement of loan, who wants to start a business, banks will lend this money to the businessman in order to start his own business. So he can start any of his business and invest this money in various ways, whether he can buy machinery, land, building, he can buy working capital like raw material and all that. So he is doing an investment, okay? And we were doing the consumption of this 70,000. So when we were spending these 70,000 on different goods and services, that was nothing but consumption. So a consumer does consumption, where ideally a producer does investment. So this is the major difference between the two, okay? Consumption and investment. So obviously they are related, because the less you consume, the more you save, the more you invest. You can say like that, yeah? The less you consume, the more you save, and the more you invest. Let's move on to the next part. Is we will talk about what is consumption function. Now, very clear, a very first statement that I have given is consumption is a function of income, which means as the income increases, the consumption will also rise. It shows what expenditure consumers wish to make on consumer goods and services at each possible level of income. Do you must be agreeing with me on this statement that I make, that if a consumer has higher income, he'll probably save more, right? So the consumption will be high for higher income people, and probably the consumption would be very low for lower income people, okay? To an extent, we can say that statement stands true. So if I'm only earning 1 lakh rupees, I will be having probably 70,000 of consumption, whereas if I'm earning only 10,000 rupees, maybe I have a consumption of 3,000 or 4,000 or whatever. But if you've seen percentages, yeah, you would say that more or less the consumption is on the similar lines, okay? Let's move on to the next one. Now, what are the various concepts of consumption? So now we are going to talk about the concepts of consumption. So when you talk about concepts of consumption, there are two major concepts of consumptions. One is average propensity to consume, and the other one is marginal propensity to consume. So two concepts of consumptions. Let's look at the first one, which is average propensity to consume. Now, it measures the percentage of income that is spent rather than it is saved. Okay, this may be calculated by single individuals who want to know whether the money is going by an economist who want to track the spending and saving habits of the entire nation. I earn an X amount of income. So I am earning 1 lakh rupees. Out of that 1 lakh rupees, I am say consuming 70,000 rupees. So what would be my consumption? So it would be 70,000 upon 1 lakhs. Okay. Whatever number that I get, that would be my average propensity to consume, which means out of my total income, this much percentage or this much is what I am consuming. So if I say that I'm let's take a very small number, 100 rupees is my income. Out of that, 80 rupees is my consumption. So my APC, that is my average propensity to consume, would be 0.8, right? So that's about your consumption. So out of my so I can say that if I have to convert it into 100, okay, so I would say that 80% of my income is gone on the consumption, okay. So this is what it is about average propensity to consume. Let's move on to the next one, which is marginal propensity to consume. Now what's marginal propensity to consume? Whenever we see this word marginal, it is the change, okay, or it is the additional. So you can say that change in consumption to change in income. Whenever we have the word marginal in any of our economics book, we've always studied that it relates to percentage change. So whatever my income has changed, depending to that, whatever my consumption has changed, when I'm taking a ratio of it, that would be my marginal propensity to consume. Say for example, if my income, change in income is 200 and my change in consumption is 100, then 100 upon 200 would be 50%. So my marginal propensity to consume is 50%. So marginal propensity to consume is the proportion of an increase in income that gets spent on the proportion on consumption. MPC is typically lower at higher incomes. If your income is high, probably the MPC would be lower. This MPC is the key determinant of Keynesian multiplier, okay, which describes the effect of increased investment or government spending as an economic stimulus. Alright, so this is the definition that you can write for marginal propensity to consume. So what did we look at? We looked at two things. One was what is the meaning of consumption? It is a function of income. Second thing we saw about what are the various components of consumption. So it was average propensity to consume, APC and MPC. APC formula is consumption upon income. MPC formula is percentage change in consumption upon change in income. Okay, let's move on to what are the psychological law of consumption. Now this is actually given by Lord Keynes. Okay, he says that the fundamental psychological law upon which we entitled to depend with great confidence, both as a priori or our knowledge of human nature and from the detailed facts of experience, is that men are disposed as a rule on the average to increase their consumption as their income increases, but not as much as the increase in income. Now all this story I will just tell you in very short, okay. Keynes says that there is a psychological law of consumption. He has created this law. What does he mean by this? He means that as our income increases, our consumption also increases, but not in the proportion of income. I repeat, not in the proportion of income. Your income would be increasing very fast, but your consumption will not catch up that pace of your income. You will tend to save more. Let's consider example of a person earning 1 lakh rupees, okay. So if he's earning 1 lakh rupees, his consumption would be 80,000. Suddenly his salary becomes 2 lakh rupees. So do you think that he will start consuming 1 lakh 90,000 or 1 lakh 80,000? Because 1 lakh he was consuming 80,000. Now 2 lakh he will he consume 1 lakh 80,000 now? Okay, that's a question mark. So I think he might go up to 2 lakh rupees. He might go up to maybe 1 lakh 20,000. Okay, but he will not go up to full, that is 2 lakh rupees, or he'll not go up to 1 lakh 90 or 1 lakh 80 like how it was for 1 lakh rupees. It was 80,000 as consumption. So what do I mean to say by all this? I mean to say that if the consumption, if the income is increasing, the consumption will also increase, but not at that pace at which your income is increasing. Probably you will tend to save more, and this is the psychological law of consumption. So increased aggregate income leads to an increased aggregate consumption, but somewhat in smaller amount. So like I told you, his income became 2 lakh, he started consuming 1 lakh of 1 lakh 20, It increased, but not as compared to as his income. So increased income is divided into consumption and saving. Whatever is the increased income, that is divided into consumption and saving. So say for example, your increased income, how much it increased? It increased by 1 lakh rupees, right? It was first 1 lakh, then it increased by 1 lakh. So out of that 1 lakh, another 20,000 you consumed, and remaining 80,000 what you did, you saved. So that is what it is. An increase in aggregate income is unlikely to lead either to a less consumption or less saving than before. So if your aggregate income is increasing, it is unlikely to lead either to less consumption. You will not do less consumption, or you will not do less saving also. So obviously if your income is increasing, you will do a little more consumption and more of saving. So this is what it is. Now let's move on to the next part, which is what are the implications of implications of this law of consumption. So one of the implication is strategic importance of investment. So this law is focusing on the strategic importance of investment. This law is telling us about how investment is important and why people are doing more investments when their income rises. So obviously we save in the banks, or we save in any of the financial institutions, or we save for our future requirements. That is it. Second is possibility of general overproduction and unemployment. Now what happens is if you are saving more, so that will be invested more, right? And if it is invested more, there would be probably situations where there will be overproduction. If you're doing overproduction, because your consumption is less, so people might not consume what is produced. That means your supply is going to be more than your demand. So if supply is going to be more than your demand, that is a situation of overproduction. If there is overproduction, then producers might feel that now we've already produced more, so we don't require these resources. So labors are not required, and now let us remove those labors, let us lay off them. So when you're laying off these labors, again it would be leading to unemployment. So it is all a vicious circle. Next is about the refutation of Say's law. So Keynes' psychological law of consumption refutes Say's law of markets. According to Say's law, supply creates its own demand. In the last video we saw that. In other words, marginal propensity to consume is equal to unity, that's one. But according to psychological law of consumption, marginal propensity to consume is less than one. That is, demand for consumption does not increase in the same ratio in which the income or the supply does. So this guy Say was saying that the marginal propensity to consume, which means the additional change in income and the additional change in your consumption is one, is equal. Whatever changes in income are happening and whatever changes in consumption are happening are equal. That's what Say was saying. But Keynes directly rejects it. Keynes says that this is not true. In fact, what happens actually is, if there is a change in income, that is always going to be greater than the change in consumption. That is what Keynes says. So this is the difference between the two. I hope that makes sense, right? Next one is over saving gap. Now how much is to be saved? More saving is done. If the income is rising, then more and more of more saving will happen, and probably there will be less and less of consumption. Last is peaks and troughs of the trade cycle. On the basis of this law, we can explain that peaks and troughs and the upper turning point of the trade cycles. When trade cycle reaches the highest limit, income is maximum but consumption lags behind. Consequently, demand for goods falls and trade cycles takes a downturn. When it reaches to the lowest limit, income falls considerably, but people try their best to maintain their previous standard of living so that consumption expenditure does not fall as much as income does. Demand cannot fall beyond a minimum level. Hence, trade cycle once again takes a upward turn. So they are talking about the income. So if the income falls, okay, the consumption will also fall, but not to that extent to what the income fell, right? Because what happens here is, okay, so when income falls, the consumption will also fall, but not at that proportion to which the income fell, because basic consumptions is always going to happen. So that is the meaning of the last point. Okay, so these were the implications of the psychological law of consumption according to Keynes. Now let us move on to his name is John Maynard Keynes. Okay, now let's move on to the next one, that is factors influencing consumption function. What are the factors influencing consumption function? So there are two factors that influence consumption function: subjective factors and objective factors. Under subjective factors you have certain points, and under objective factors also you have certain points. Let us study those points clearly. Okay, so subjective factors are those which relate to psychological characteristics of human nature and social practices and institutions. So whenever you are dealing with the psychological factors of human nature, you are talking about the subjective factors. Okay, so let us see the first subjective factor, that is individual factor. So in individual factors you have first one is foresightedness. Okay, so future is uncertain, hence individuals gifted with foresight always have in order to fulfill their anticipated future needs, cutting down their consumption. So we are seeing that why a person consumes less when the income rises. So one is about the foresightedness. So in foresightedness, it says that individuals have this foresightedness that future is uncertain. They might just require there might just be an emergency for which they require money, so they need to make arrangements for that money right now. Second is about economic independence. So people want to be financially sound, they want to be independent as early as possible, okay, in terms of finances, and therefore they save more. Okay, this is the next point. Next is enlarged income in future. They want to get a lot of money in the future, right? So when I retire at the age of 60 or 65, I want lump sum money in my hand so that I can take care of all my requirements at that time. So enlarged income, I save more. Occupational motive, so I have certain occupational motive, maybe I want to start a new occupation, I want to start a business later on, so for that I'm making arrangements, I'm saving more. Next is status in the society. I want to be an independent person, I want to show people that I have a good standard of living, so for that I save more. And last is precautionary motive. There could be ailments that we might face when we go up to a certain age. Okay, once you cross a certain age, for that you tend to save more. So these are certain objectives for which you save more. Then there are other more also, like liquidity preference. People require more money, more cash. Okay, then other could be they want to modernize, they want to have all the systems with them. So these are certain individual factors for which you save more. Let's move on to the objective factors. Now what are the objective factors? So the very first objective factor is change in money income. Okay, so change in money income is where when income increases, consumption also increases, and when income decreases, consumption also decreases. However, consumption increases less than increase in income. This is because after basic needs people are fulfilled, they have the position to save more and more. Okay, so change in money income means when the income is rising, the consumption is also rising, but not in the same proportion like income, rather people will save more. Second is the change in distribution of income. So change in real income. Okay, so change in real income is when the prices of goods fall, then value of money income of people rises. In other words, the real income rises. When supposing a product is becoming cheap, okay, you were buying milk at 40 rupees a liter, now milk has become 30 rupees a liter, so you're left with 10 rupees more with yourself, right? So that is your real income increases, okay? Consequently, they begin to spend more on consumption. So if you're left with more money, now you'll spend more, you can buy more from that 10 rupees, you can buy something else from that, right? So this is it. Next, when prices of goods are rising, then the value of monetary falls, which means vice versa. Initially you were buying 40 rupees a liter milk, now the milk became 60 rupees a liter, you have to give more 20 rupees for that milk, okay? So eventually what happens, you are left with less money, so now you will consume more less, okay? You will not spend on other goods also, you will try to be conservative, right? Next is change in distribution of income. So propensity to consume is also influenced by the change in distribution of income. If distribution of income is equal, propensity to consume will be more. That means they are saying that if distribution of income is equal across classes, then the propensity to consume will be more. Okay. On the contrary, if the distribution of income is unequal, rich people have large chunk of national income. Next is about windfall gains and losses. Windfall gains and losses is propensity to consume increases as a result of windfall gains, which means suddenly you got a lottery, okay, of 1 crore rupees. So you will spend more, you will spend luxuriously, okay. Change in expectations. People's expectations regarding future events influence their propensity to consume. So if your expectations is that probably you want to settle abroad after you retire, okay, so you will save more money now and then consume less, okay. Then other would be the fiscal policy. If the government has imposed high taxes, then what you will do, you are left with less disposable income. If you're left with less disposable income, you will not be able to save more, okay. So these are the certain reasons for which we can say that these are the factors influencing consumption function, certain subjective factors and certain objective factors. Yeah, so let's move on to the next part. Now we will talk about savings now. Yeah, so just a minute. What is saving? So saving is a function of saving is nothing but income minus consumption. What is your income? Your income is 100, your consumption is 50. So 100 minus 50 would be 50. Your saving is 50. But what are the various components of saving? So there are two components of saving, like of consumption also. One is average propensity to save and marginal propensity to save. Okay. So what is marginal propensity to save? It is the percentage change in income upon the percentage change in. Yeah, it would be the percentage change in, it is a change in savings upon the change in income, okay? And average propensity to save would be your savings upon the income. So how much is the percentage of saving from your income? That will be told by the propensity to save, average propensity to save. Marginal propensity to save will tell you how much is the additional increase in income you are saving, out of that how much are you saving. That will be the marginal propensity to save, okay? This is it. Next is investment. Now what is investment? Investment is nothing but the increase in the capital equipments, okay? So if I have money, I'm buying more machineries and all that, that becomes investments. So you do investments either in stocks, you do in capital assets, you do in various forms, right? Now when you talk about investments, one is autonomous investments. Autonomous investments means which does not change with the change in the income. It is independent of the income, okay? So in irrespective of the income, you are doing this investment, so it becomes an autonomous investment. You need a house, right? Even if you don't have much money, you at least buy a normal house. Yeah, so that becomes an autonomous investment, okay? Similarly, the government has to spend on roads, transportation. So these are all autonomous investments, okay? induce is when you're doing it purposely, okay? You're doing it extra. But so when there is a change in income and there is a change in investment, that becomes an induced investment. So that's the difference between the two, autonomous and induced. You might get a difference between these also in your examinations, which you have to explain, right? So this is it from my end. If you all have any questions, you all can obviously write a mail to me and ask for any kind of doubts. We'll just quickly see, since we have a little time, we'll just quickly see what all the topics are that we did today. We spoke about consumption and investment. We spoke that there's a relation between consumption and investments, okay? Both of these are dependent on your income, okay? So income will have certain consumption that will be left out with savings, and that savings could be invested. It's like that, right? A straight line flow. Now, we spoke about consumption. What is consumption? It is a function of income. Higher the income, higher the consumption. Okay. Then we spoke about what is APC and MPC. APC is average propensity to consume. MPC is marginal propensity to consume. APC is consumption upon income. Okay, it will tell you how much of your income are you saving. That's your APC. And MPC is nothing but it basically deals with change in consumption upon change in income. The additional income, out of that additional income, how much is the additional consumption that you're doing? That would be MPC. Okay, then we did the psychological law of consumption. Psychological law of consumption states that how a consumer, when his income increases, his consumption will also increase, but not in the same proportion as his income, right? Then we spoke about the implications of psychological consumption, okay? Then we spoke about what are the factors influencing consumption function. So there were individual factors, there were objective factors, subjective factors, and objective factors. Objective factors were more relatable to the individuals, whereas objective factors were in general, right? Then we spoke about what is saving. So saving is nothing but whatever income you have, subtract whatever you consume, whatever you're left with, that is your saving. Then we did what are the various components of saving. So there are two components of saving, APC and MPC. APC is saving upon income. MPC is change in savings upon change in income, right? So and we studied about the last concept, that is investment. So investment is nothing but the increment in your capital equipments, okay? So thank you, everybody.